just a bloke in a bar.
What is up, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome to another episode of Bloke in a Bar, brought to you, powered by the beer of rugby league, Bloke in a Bar beer. Make sure to grab a case from your local. Go to our website, blokeinabar.com. We have a store locator. You put in your address. You find out the closest one. You go down there. You grab it. You become a bigger, better, stronger man or woman. That's how it all works, I think. But when we're talking about big, strong men, we got the great Cam Murray here. What's going on, brother?
Not much, bro. Great to be here.
Mate, how have you been? You've got the grand final appearance. You're obviously in a sling there. You've got a reconstruction. What's it been like, bro? What's it been like?
Yeah, it's been a crazy year, man. Yeah, obviously really disappointing to finish like that. Come so far, but pull up short. But, you know, that's footy. That's the way it goes. Haven't been doing much lately. I've just been kind of off the grid, just like cruising around, relaxing, forgotten about footy a little bit, and just trying to get my shoulder right. So,
what did it like as a kid? You're sitting there, you always like imagine what it would be like to be in a grand final. Did it live up to everything you expected?
Yeah, I don't know. So it was a hard one because, like, on one hand, I could immerse myself in the whole sort of spectacle of what the grand final was, but I'm a pretty, like, nervous person, so I didn't want to buy into it too much. Yep. I guess the silver lining of not being in Sydney around our fans, although I'd have heard really good things about how good grand final week is at home.
Yeah.
The good thing was we were sort of hidden from that hype a little bit. I've been off social media for a couple of weeks. I just didn't want to see anything.
Smart.
Didn't want to talk to anyone. Yep. I just wanted to get through my daily routine.
Yeah.
One day at a time, one training session at a time. So yeah, it's I haven't really looked back on it too much, and you know, it hasn't really sunk in yet. So yeah, I don't know. It'll definitely be something I look back on, I think, in a couple of years' time, reflect on it. You know, how big of a dream it was, but you know, hopefully there's bigger and better things to come.
100%. And man, like, it sounds funny coming from me, being like, I built everything on social media, but if I'm like a coach and that, I know you can't tell your players to do certain things, but I'm going into finals, especially like the business end of, like, you know, prelims and grand finals, I'm saying to the guys, get off social media, like, if you can, or like create a spare account that isn't following any rugby league. No one knows who it is. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's a good idea.
You know, a fakey account.
Yeah,
and then fakey. Like only follow things that you enjoy but aren't rugby league.
Yeah, for sure. I think Wayne's a big advocate of that too. Yeah. He's really good to have around us. Obviously, a lot of finals experience. So yeah, he helped us through how to handle a little bit.
So don't name the account Ma'am Curry. Because then we'll know it's Cam Murray.
Yeah, okay.
Curry.
Nah, I won't make it obvious.
It's got like the glasses with the moustache and the nose.
Maybe.
It's like, is that Cam Murray in a fake account?
Ma'am Curry.
Yeah, so, like, I mean, walk us through the build-up to the grand final, because a lot of people, including myself, I was like, you know, Rabbitohs. So when you lost twice by 50 points, I was like one of the only people, and you can back me up on this is on tape, I was like, if there's one coach that can get the boys up to win a grand final, it's Wayne Bennett, even though you just lost by 50. So I still had belief in you. But then when Latrell went and got suspended, I was like, fuck, I don't know if they can make the grand final without Trell. Like, he's so important to them. But you proved everyone wrong. What was the build-up like going into that grand final? Did you feel confident? Did you feel, I mean, your defense had improved so much since the middle of the year. What was it like?
Yeah, so you hit a couple points on the head there. I think the turning point for us was our attitude in defense, especially from those two sort of games where we kind of fell apart a little bit. So yeah, that was definitely something we focused on, and something that I think we did improve, you know, week to week, coming off the back of those pretty disappointing and embarrassing losses. So
you didn't play in those losses, though, hey?
No, I didn't play. I was
clearly it was. Yeah. Is that what you tell the boys? Boys, I didn't play.
Nah, one team. That's it.
If it was me, I would. I'd tell.
Yeah,
fucking hope I'd tell. Probably why I didn't play much NRL, because I was a fucking idiot. Sorry.
What else? Yeah, and like you said, Wayne, you know, he's just built for that. I remember after we lost, I'm not sure which one it was, but he just knows exactly what to do. He probably won't love me saying this, but we went into Redfern. It was Monday morning. Everyone was kicking stones, depressed. We got beat by 50. And Wayne put one of his favorite songs in the gym and walked through, started dancing, took his shirt off.
He's the master. You know,
yeah, and he just got everyone back in the good mood. It's yep. exactly what we needed.
Yep.
And from then on, we forgot about it. And we just, we screwed our heads back on our shoulders and we just did what we needed to do. So, yeah, that was, I think, you know, that sort of period was it was really good for us to go through. It was a good turning point.
Mm.
And then leading into the grand final, obviously, those two losses, everyone wrote us off. Losing Latrell, everyone wrote us off.
Mm.
And I think we used that as motivation. It was probably one of the best things that could have you know, been released out there.
Mm.
And we really used that. We wanted to prove people wrong.
Mm.
And yeah, I think we did that. We stuck to what we knew, my confidence. And I know everyone else in my team, their confidence was sky high because we'd had a few you know, tough games leading into that, especially the one against Penrith. I think around 24 it was.
Yep.
We lost, but that was a good little rehearsal for what was to come.
Mm.
We knew if we stuck to our guns and did what we knew we could do, we could match up with the top teams, and that's exactly how we approached it. And yeah, I think that's why we ran into so much success during the finals.
Mate, Wayne's the master. I have a similar story with Wayne. It was 2008. And we had like a few losses back to back, and they were really poor losses. And he pulled us all into the video session room, and this was heading into finals. And he said to everyone, "Look, boys, like if yous are done with the season, like if yous really feel like this isn't the season that we can make a push for the premiership, you need to let me know, and we'll organise Mad Monday. We'll organise a trip away. I want to be on the same page as you. So if you want to pack it in, let me know. That's totally fine. We'll do it." And obviously, reverse psychology. Yeah. You got the boys all fucking arced up. No, fuck that. No, fuck that.
Yeah.
But it was so good just to get on the same page, and similar to you, to know to come in to the changing room and just do something to lighten the mood and let all the boys know everything's okay. It's all good.
Yeah, I know. He's so good at it. And, you know, some things like that is like a real subtle message. Mm. Others a little bit out there, like it was when he started dancing in front of him and all that. But
were the boys whooping up when he started dancing?
Everyone was into it. Everyone was going off their heads. It was the best. Yeah, so he's I'm going to miss him because, you know, it still hasn't really sunk in that, you know, last 3 years are done and, I'm probably never going to get coached by Wayne again. So, yeah, it's been really special playing under him last 3 years.
And again, for people listening, there's also a negative side to that. And what I mean by it is sometimes you may have a good win and you walk in and Wayne's like angry. And you're like, what? But he knows when to like make sure you don't get ahead of yourself.
Yeah.
So, like, I'm not sure if that happened with you too, but like sometimes
it did.
Yeah, okay.
We beat the Roosters by like, it was 50 to 12 or something. We flogged them. But he was off it because he knew Latrell was gone.
Oh, really?
And he knew there was a few things that we did that wasn't characteristic of us.
Okay.
And so he was off it. Like probably like one of the worst I've seen him after a game.
Wow.
So yeah, that's just Wayne Bennett.
But he just knows the right thing to do to manage the team's heads, you know?
Yeah.
Heads, because headspace is honestly 80% of the battle in rugby league. Everyone trains as hard as each other. They really do. Like I've been to a few different clubs and, you know, probably at the start, Bronco, there were some clubs that were a little bit ahead when it came to like training facilities and that. But when it comes to the actual fitness and that, most clubs train as hard as each other. Okay, so walk us through the so the first week you beat Penrith in a like real close game. Was that the week where you just got a mountain of confidence? Where you're like, wow, we're here.
Yeah, it definitely helped. I've probably been up there with one of the best feelings that I'd had after a game.
Yep.
You know, including Origin wins and stuff like that, because we just knew it was so good for our confidence. We knew that, I guess there was that overhanging idea or fear that we'd been knocked out in the prelim final the last 3 years.
Yep.
And we knew every single one of those years we'd had to play back to back.
Yeah.
So we knew a week off was going to be massive for us to get past that sort of little voodoo thing. Yep. So, yeah, everyone was stoked. A lot of confidence there, and yeah, definitely helped out.
Mate, it's such an important win, because then you move Penrith to the other side. So Storm and Penrith had to play each other, and Manly, although good, not on the same level as those guys this year. So the Manly game, did you know that you had enough to beat them? Not convincingly, but. Were you very confident going to that game?
Yeah, we were. We just, and it wasn't too dissimilar to, you know, all the big games we played in the finals, we just knew if we played our footy, we'd be able to get the job done. We knew if we just, like I said, stuck to our brand of footy and everyone had confidence in everyone, everyone just did their job, we knew we could get the job done. So, you know, that's how we approached the game. And yeah, I think we did that anyway for the first 60 minutes, maybe last 10 might have been, you know, a little bit of a hiccup. But yeah, we knew we were able to do that. And yeah, that was another great feeling, just, you know, being able to get past that prelim and know that we had the big dance left.
So the big dance rolls around. What's the feeling like that leading into it?
Yeah, I don't know. It's hard to look back on it. I don't remember much, to be honest. I remember I got a little bit too hyped, especially before the Penrith game. I knew it was a big game, and I think I played it in my head a little bit too much.
Mm.
And I don't think that my energy levels, the way I played, I wasn't real happy with the way I played. And I knew that I just needed to chill out a bit. So like I told you before, I, you know, got rid of social media, didn't think too much about it. I just stuck to my normal routine and didn't buy into too much hype. So I just went about my normal routine, and I told myself, like, you know, I gave myself moments of telling myself, this is the last time you're going to play with some of your heroes. This is the last time you're going to be coached by the master coach.
Yep.
You've got one week left of training. Just enjoy every minute of it.
Mm.
And yeah, I think happiness off the field, happiness during training definitely translates onto it. So, and you play better when you're happy. So that's all I was focused on doing. And, and that's where my head was at leading up to the big game.
And so, yeah, the big dance, it happens. You're running out. What's the feeling like running out Suncorp like that?
Yeah, it's cool. I love running out to the packed Suncorp. I think it's probably the best venue in rugby league when it's packed. So, I knew that was what we were looking forward to. Yeah, it was just really special. We lined up for the anthem, all our reserves and people that weren't playing lined up in front of us. And we just knew that was it. It was really special. It was definitely one of the biggest arenas I played in, probably top three hardest games I've ever played in as well. So, yeah, it was. It's hard to look back on now because obviously a real disappointing to pull up short. But yeah, it was a great experience.
What about the game? So it was like 52 tackles, zero miss. Were you just done? Like, were you gassed?
Yeah, I was gassed, especially halfway through that second half. And I normally know when I'm feeling like that. Wayne knows, he'll normally take me off. But I just knew because I hadn't gone off yet, I knew he was just going to keep me on. And I, in the back of my head, I was like, fuck. Get me off. But I also knew that the reason he was keeping me on is because he trusted me and I didn't want to let him down.
Yeah.
So I just did everything to push through. I just tried to make a difference. I tried to do everything I could, and it was just unfortunate. We were just
What about that when you made that line break at the end there?
Yeah, I've been running that over my head for the last 3 weeks.
Just really?
I could have done different. You know,
I don't think you could have done it. There was no one there.
Yeah, look, I think I looked for support. And I think, you know, that sort of moment there where I look for support, I probably could have done something different. But, you know, could have, should have stuff. So
honestly, there was no one there, eh? That was my issue, was that no one was inside you. There should have been someone pushing up. But I know what you mean, though. Like, there's been times when I made breaks and you're like, should have I stepped left and gone towards the wing? And there would have been maybe the winger there instead of going infield.
Yeah.
But, do you remember the feeling of when you broke the line?
There's no feeling. There's just do your best.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I look for support. I'm not used to being in the clear that much, so I don't really know what to do.
Yep,
so I need to work on that.
Yep.
If that's going to be characteristic of my game in the future, but I don't know. I honestly don't know. I can't describe it. It was just I just knew we were down by 2 points. I just knew we just needed something. I tried my best. We got tackled to try to play it fast. And credit to Penrith. They scrambled well. They did well. And that's what they do well as a team. That's why they won. They were they just work hard for each other. So, it was such a great experience.
So what did Wayne say to you after the game? Just, boys, you did your best.
Yeah, so the big thing Wayne was driving that week, and he was hinting at a little bit a few weeks beforehand, was he didn't want to have regret. He wanted to have disappointment if we were to lose.
Yeah.
So it was always disappointment over regret. Regret is that you know you could have beat them, but you beat yourself. Disappointment is you got beat by a better team.
Mm.
So Yeah, that's what he said. And I guess a silver lining for that situation is, you know, the coach is proud of us.
Yeah.
We never gave up and, you know, that's what it is.
Yeah, most Rabbitohs fans I've spoken to have been like, mate, like they left it all out there. There was not a single Rabbitohs fan that's been like, you know what, they had a crack and just it wasn't our night.
Yeah.
Which is all you can ask for. It really is all you can ask for. Okay, so take us back all the way back to the start. We've got to the pinnacle, but take us back to the start. Obviously born in New South Wales.
Yeah.
Played Mascot Jets.
Yeah.
Attended Newington College. Completed HSC in 2015. Says academically, Murray performed well, achieving first rank at the college in Earth and Environment Science with a band 6, a raw mark of 91. I don't know what that means, but please tell me what that means, bro.
Oh, that was my favorite subject, Earth and Environmental Science. I loved it so much. And, you know, at school, it's like anything, like a job. How much you enjoy your job is based on how good your boss is, how good your teacher is.
Yeah.
I had a weapon teacher. I loved him.
Yep.
I had a good class. So I just enjoyed it. And I like science too. So
yeah,
I gave it a crack. And there was only one class in the whole year.
Yeah.
I was competing against 30 students. So it's not really, it's not really like an achievement in itself. But
yeah,
I'll claim it.
So did you enjoy school?
Yeah, I did. I love Newington. I wish I went there from year 7, and no disrespect to Marcelin. I love my time at Marcelin. Bucko can probably.
Oh, are you from there?
Yeah.
Is that a shit school? The Battlers. Okay.
So I went there year 7A, I went there in Newington year 9. I loved it. I loved playing rugby there. I loved the school. I loved the teachers. I loved the opportunity you got. I went to Tonga in year 10 for...
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's when sick. I was 15. We got a brother school over there. Spent 2 weeks over there. That was amazing.
Were they big boys? Like, because you were playing Union?
Not really. Yeah, Union. They weren't massive, but really? Just is such a lesson in humility and in respect. You know, it's just... they get up at like 6 o'clock or 5:30 or something. They make their own breakfast. They sing hymns in the morning. They're just so disciplined over there, so respectful. So it was something that had a really big impact on me as a young kid, and it was great for me to go over there. So just the stuff like that at Newington, I loved it. And obviously I love my last year in year 12 as well. Obviously I was really happy, and I look back on it now, school life and rugby life, I had some success. So it was a really fun year for me.
Didn't you captain your Newington side, and you won the GPS?
Yep.
The same year?
Yep.
Was that year 12?
Year 12, yep.
Was it, because like a lot of, not a lot, but people speak about your rugby, you know, upbringing a bit. Was there a chance of going down rugby route, or did you just enjoy the school part of it?
I don't know. Well, look, there was always a chance, but my heart was always with rugby league. I started league earlier. I've always enjoyed it. Oh, look, I don't know if I enjoyed it more because I had so much fun in my last year at school.
Yep.
But I just always had in my mind, like cemented in my mind, that I wanted to play for South. I wanted to play in the NRL. So that was, if I got the opportunity to do that, that was always going to be my pathway. And that's what I chose. So, I look back, I miss Union. I miss schoolboy footy. Like I said, one of my most favorite years, I think, year 12, just had so much fun. Love playing with the boys there. Love playing in the GPS comp. League always had my heart.
Were you approached by any Union sides?
Yeah, I was approached by, I think the Waratahs offered me a contract. And it was a good contract too. So, but at the same time, I got one from South. So, you know, there wasn't much competition there. I was always going to go with South.
Yeah,
so.
Okay.
I definitely wouldn't rule it out in the future. It's something that I'd love to look at down the line. But for now, my focus, especially after, you know, such a big couple of years, getting so close, I definitely want to win a premiership here with South and see how far we can go. And I definitely want to make sure that, you know, with the group that I've got at South now, that we leave when I do leave the place, I leave it in a better place than, you know, when I got there. So it's such a proud club. So many good players there. So it's definitely something that's going to be pretty tough, but something that I'm really focused on.
Well, when you got like yourself, Trell, like you've got some good, good young players. I think the future is very, very bright. Reynolds is a big loss.
Yeah.
Like he's a big loss.
Yeah, I agree.
On and off the field, you know, massive pest, but he seems to be very energetic off the field.
Yeah.
And you need players like that. And I know Cody Walker is also a pest. But sometimes two pests are better than one.
Yeah, always. Two pests are always better than
and
one.
And when they go to war, it's even better.
Yeah. Man, you can't replace that.
100%. Okay, so it was always... So did any other NRL clubs approach you at that age? Or you were just nah.
I don't even think I was off contract. So I think I was contracted for the next year, maybe. So, like, it was just South.
Okay. Matt's a South fan, so he loves hearing his shit. It's disgusting. Honestly, absolutely disgusting. Okay, so what about growing up? How did you get did you get a scholarship to go to the good school or did you?
Yeah, so I tried out to go to Newington Year 7. Obviously, I needed to get a scholarship to go there.
Yeah.
Didn't get one Year 7.
Just for people listening, Newington, the cost to go there is quite substantial. So if you go there, usually your parents are well off. And there's some kids there where their parents are like crazy well off.
Yeah.
And obviously, I'm assuming your parents were okay, but not that well off.
Yeah, exactly. You're right. So I needed a scholarship to go there. It just wasn't doable. So I tried in Year 7, didn't get one.
So scholarship for sport, did you try or?
So I think they don't give out sports scholarships. You needed to get an all-round scholarship. So there needed to be a level of academia there as well. So you sit tests to try and get in on an all-round scholarship.
Yep.
So I tried to do that. I don't know how I went in the test, but I mustn't have done that well. and then I tried again in Year 9 and I was lucky. I played a bit of Randwick rugby as well outside of obviously school footy and I met a few people there that went to Newington. So
yep.
I had like a bit of a segue in through like the Randwick community.
Yep.
And I got a half scholarship and that was enough. So so I went there in Year 9 and I love my time ever since.
Yeah.
Really, really lucky to get
there. Yeah, like schools like Newington and, private schools that are like, there's private schools and then there's, private schools that have quite substantial resources and that. If you can get to those schools far out, they provide such a good experience compared to all of the other schools. And don't get me wrong, there's benefits and negatives for everything, but everyone that kind of goes to Newington, it sounds like, colleges like Newington, it sounds like they have a real connection to the school. Whereas like all I remember from high school is pain and anxiety.
Yeah, that's what I find too. Like I speak to people and like I'm so passionate about my school and I know people that went to Newington, they love it too. And I just don't really, like you said, I'm not rubbishing any other school.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't see that same passion.
Yeah.
There's just something about it. I don't know. I can't describe it.
Yeah. I mean, my school was good, but at the same time, the first few years after you leave school, it was like, man, I miss school so much. And I'm sure you probably do as well. Yeah. I didn't miss school one bit. I can't remember a single day where I was like, this is great. Every day was shit. Every day, man. Oh my God. Had no friends. Fucking all I did was play sport and my friends didn't play sport. So it was fucking torture. Dogs.
That hurts.
you're right though. Like Newington and schools like that, they provide such a good foundation. And also it seems that like post school, if you're a graduate of Newington and they're, you're both successful, it seems like you guys network really well. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think they do. Look, I haven't really tapped into like the old boy network too much, but I think that, I think that is a big benefit to, to go into a school like that is the networking and the connections that you get afterwards. So, I could go through lists of the perks of going to such a great school like Newington.
So walk us through when you won the GPS championship, walk us through that game. Was it a close game?
Yeah, that was honestly, to this day, probably, one of the, most enjoyable and nerve wracking games I've ever played. There's probably some footage of it on YouTube, but we were playing Riverview and the way that the GPS season works is that there's no semis or grand finals. It's all based on points.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So you win based on how many wins versus losses you are.
Yeah.
And back when I was playing, you played every school twice. I think now it's only once. Mm. So you can't afford to lose.
That's crazy.
Yeah. So
every game is like you'd be Wigan.
Yeah, exactly. I was, shitting yourself. So, so the last game was against Riverview. Riverview couldn't win it. Us and Scots had both lost once. Every other team had lost twice.
Yeah.
So us and Scots both needed to win. We weren't playing each other. We were playing different teams.
Wow.
So we were playing Riverview and Riverview, a good side. We played in front of a home ground at Newington and it was packed. It was probably as good as school footy gets. And there was a minute left. I think it was like 42 all. It was weird as.
What? Yeah. 42 all.
It was crazy.
What about Riverview just trying to like upset the party?
Oh, yeah.
Dogs. Fun. Let the boys win.
Yeah. So there was a minute left, and one of our props, his, he actually came over in year 9 or year 10 from Tupu College, the school I visited in Tonga in year 10.
Okay, yep.
So he was on scholarship too. And he crept around the ruck and he just picked up the ball and he ran straight through the ruck under the post. And it was Old Boys Day as well. So all the Old Boys on the hill ran on the field because we knew we won. Yes. The whole school ran on the field. No it was way. Crazy, man. It was like, it was up there as like one of the best feelings I've had. It was so good. And yeah, we won the premiership. We were co-premiers with Scots because they won as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was...
Who did you beat them in during the year? Or they
yeah,
beat
we beat Scots round one, a massive upset. No, everyone wrote us off.
Well, then you should win it.
Yeah, well, yeah. Surely that's... Exactly, but we lost to Joey's later on.
But like you beat the team that...
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I understand, but I just don't...
What about
just,
points differential? Were you ahead points differential?
I'm not... Probably not.
Probably
but
not, but was, you beat them still.
Yeah, I know. So I guess that you can claim that.
Bloody Scots. Kiss. Give me a break. Always cheating those Scots bastards. I don't know. I've got no idea. I'm just saying, talking shit. That's in like the cool thing is everyone running on field. You couldn't have that in the NRL, so you got to experience it at school.
Yeah,
you would have been kings for the day. For the week. Mate,
it was unreal. We're walking around like with a shield.
Yep.
Weeks later was the best.
And like the whole school, because you're like all in a community together, and you see each other every single day. Whereas like it's not like every day. You know, again, it's better to win an NRL grand final, but it's not like every day you're rocking up and there's 1,000 Rabbitohs fans that you're constantly engaged with. Whereas like a school, you see each other every day, you can enjoy it.
100%. Like you walk around and like people in year 7, they look up to you. Yeah, it's crazy. To them almost. So 100%. It was a weird dynamic at school because we're so young, but mad experience.
Okay, so you get signed with the Rabbitohs. Did you go straight from school into the first grade squad or did you go to 20s?
So I was actually played SG ball. Year out of school because I was only 17 in my last year at school, so I was still eligible to play SG ball. So we played SG ball. We came up short. Matt King was our coach.
Oh yeah, yeah. Yep.
Keon played in that side.
The big fella.
Yeah. I'm not sure if there's anyone. Emre Gula from Raiders. Yep. Yeah, he played in that side. So yeah, we had a fun year. We came up short, lost in the prelim final, and then. Because the SG ball season is like very early in the year, I transitioned in the 20s, I played a few games there, and then I went to reserve grade, finished off the year there.
Mm.
And that was, it was a massive challenge for me because like I went from playing 18-year-old kids to playing men in the same year. So it was very different to me and probably more difficult transition for me than from reserve grade to first grade, I think.
Yeah, because of the men thing.
Yeah, that was my progression. And then the next year I debuted against the Bronx on Anzac Day in 2017.
Do you remember your first, so you didn't train with first grade that first year, but then you got caught?
I did. So I had a few, like, you know how they get you in early and you do a few sessions. I did a little bit of that. And that was, that was crazy for me. So that 2016 was a big year for me because I was slowly starting to blood me around like the big top 30 players. Like
Greg Inglis, Burgess.
Yeah, exactly. I sat in a spot next to like Sam when I was 18.
Wow.
Sam and Sutto, and I ended up going into that locker the year later. So
I'm so glad Burgess won the SAS or at least got the chance to show people what he's like. Don't get me wrong, I know he's made mistakes.
Yeah.
But people that don't know the inner sanctum, Sam Burgess is like a leader of men. When you talk about the elite of the elite. So, and I think a lot of footy fans didn't know just how elite he was, excellent he is.
Yeah.
So you sat next to him.
Yeah.
Quite a bit.
Yeah. I sat next to him. I only went in like once or twice a week, maybe like once or twice a fortnight. Sat next to him, asked him heaps of questions. I was a pretty curious kid. So, and he was happy to answer them. He was a really good mentor for me. And I think back now, I think, you know, a lot of the values I have in terms of like mental resilience and strength and the way I approach my footy is because of my experience with him as a young kid.
Yep.
So, yeah, I couldn't think of a better mentor in that sort of sense. And absolutely. Yeah, it was so good for me. I was just a little kid. I was starstruck every time I went in.
Mate, he was, fuck, he was good. Yeah. Fuck, he was good.
Yeah.
And just never took a backward step. I can't think of a single game where he catted it or, you know what I mean? Like every, not catted it, but there's a lot of the time, like they might, players that are seen as tough or whatever, they'll have quiet games where they're not involved in the trying to dominate the opposition. I feel like every single game he was in, he was trying to dominate.
Yeah, he's just one of those special players. You just, once in a generational player.
Mm.
Yeah, like you said, he just never took a back.
Imagine him in Origin.
Oh, man.
Imagine him in Origin. Holy moly. Okay, so the next year you go full-time. What was it like getting used to the professionalism, the level, the standard of a full-time first grader?
Yeah, it was a slow transition for me. I probably was a bit naive, took the piss a little bit, I think, at the start. I just didn't do what I do now. I didn't know what it took to be a professional athlete and get to the standard that I want to get to. So it took me a few games to debut, and then I got dropped, and then I ended up coming on the back end of the season, and that's when I really started to get my shit together and really start playing well.
Mm.
Every year since then has been like a gradual progression and change in my mentality and the seriousness in which I approach my footy and my prep and my rehab and my recovery and all that stuff. And I'm just really, even now, I think I'm really starting to sort of delve into what it takes to to be at the top level. So it's been a real slow transition for me, and I'm still learning. But definitely early on, I definitely think that I sort of fell into the trap of just being there instead of competing, I guess, and just being involved, but maybe not as committed as I should have been.
It's kind of like when you're younger. I was guilty of it too. You rock up and you train as hard as you can, but once training finishes, you're kind of like, okay, I'm done.
Yeah,
I'm going home now, or I'm doing whatever. Whereas as you get a bit older, you realize, no, it's 24/7, you're a professional athlete. Yeah. It's not just, you don't just do what the coaches say, you do what the coaches say, plus extras, plus stretching, plus little things in your game you need to work on.
Yeah.
And so did you feel like it took you a couple of years to really realize that?
Yeah, definitely. Like I definitely took it for granted. It took me a couple of years to realize that. Even a couple of years in, I probably look back now and don't think that I was as professional as I probably should have been. So, it probably took me, even my first year in Origin, like you only had to look at players like Teddy, who, is probably one or two at the NRL right now, and just his professionalism around the way he approaches his recovery and what he does and the things, I guess the selfishness that you take as an NRL player that's necessary for you to perform at the top level.
Yep.
So yeah, it's I've taken little learning curves from a few different people in the game, but I definitely don't think I did what I needed to do.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean I was the same. I was sort of, I'm training my ass off, like I'm training really hard, that's all you need to do. But it wasn't until later that I realized no, it's got to be, you got to do everything, everything you can. What about the intensity of first grade? Do you remember any sessions where you're like, holy shit, this is intense?
Yeah, my first year of preseason was tough. It was Madge's last year at the club.
Yep.
Training was pretty intense. Wrestling sessions were intense.
Yep.
I knew it was going to be hard, but I didn't know it was going to hit me that hard in the face. So it was definitely a struggle for me. But I think that I prepared reasonably well for a young kid. And I held my own in fitness and stuff like that, but there were definitely some days where I was like, this is wild. This is crazy.
I just always remember, like, you do crazy fitness one day and you'd rock up the next day going, oh, well, surely we're going to have a light sesh. I can barely walk. And then before you know it, you're getting towed again.
And then
the next day you're getting towed again. Or it's like, oh yeah, we've just got recovery sesh tomorrow, but the recovery sesh is like 50 laps of a pool or something. You're like,
definitely like that.
Mate, torture. I'm so glad I'm past it. so you make your debut against the Broncos.
Yeah.
Was it at Suncorp?
No, it was at ANZ.
ANZ. How did the debut come about? Like, was it expected, unexpected?
It was pretty unexpected. I didn't get the tap on the shoulder till captain's run. Reno had a sore groin, and if Reno pulled out, then I was in.
Mm.
And Reno couldn't finish captain's run, so Madge told everyone at captain's run I was playing. So,
what's that feeling like?
Yeah, I can't really remember, to be honest. I think, I don't know, I always backed myself as a kid. I always backed myself there. I knew I was gonna play, so eventually. So I didn't get too excited. And characteristic of me, I try not to get too hyped up about anything, because then I start thinking too much and all that type of stuff. So yeah, I just took it slow, you know, made sure I did everything right. And then I just turned up and I just tried to think of it as another game of footy.
Yeah.
So yeah, I got on in the second half, finished the game. I don't remember much from the day. I remember, you know, one of my first tackles, Matt Gillette ran at me, and I just remember hitting him with everything I got. And I just like, and I'd hardly even like, he hardly even flinched. And I was like, far out, these guys are hard to tackle. So
yeah.
So I just,
people forget, Gillette was like one of the best back rollers in the comp for a substantial time.
Yeah. And it was tough too. Yeah. It was hard to tackle. And I just, I remember that. And then I obviously remember, like, it was a bit of controversy because they won 25-24.
Yeah.
Milford kicked the left footy field goal, but kind of like, you know, whether he dropped it or not, I'll leave everyone who remembers that game.
Didn't drop it. Are you serious? You guys, honestly, always blaming the refs, man.
I'll let them be the judge.
Always blaming the refs. A good, solid win from the Broncos. You know what? We should have won by more. We got dudded a million calls.
Yeah, one of our tries got disallowed too. I don't want to say anything, so yeah, it was definitely a memorable day,
memorable experience. But you said that, so you came into first grade and then you got dropped from first grade. Were you dropped or were you more just like the boys came back?
So I played next week and we got flogged by Manly 40-0. I think, you know, I don't know where Madge's head was, but obviously you get beat by that much. I think. I wouldn't say he blamed me, but I would just say that, you know, he probably needed to make some changes, and you know, my head was probably closer to the chopping board. So he just said, "Mate, go back to reserve grade, keep doing your thing, doing really well for us, and you'll be back here in no time." And so it took me, you know, it took me ages. It took me like 10 or 15 rounds to get back in. But once I got in, I can't remember what the first
20 game. Rounds. It took you like 18 rounds. 18 so rounds. Debuted round 8.
Yeah.
And then, it says you scored your first try in round 24.
Oh, yeah. Against the Warriors, I remember that.
Against the Warriors. Yeah, walk us through the try.
Yeah, I just went straight through. I think Reno or someone dropped me. Mm. And I just went straight through and was on the post, and it just happened so quick. Boys are happy for me. I was happy, and I don't know. That's it.
So when you got called back into the side, did you make a point of like, I'm not leaving again, or were you just kind of like,
I
happy
honestly
to be
don't
there?
Remember. Like, I don't even know who I played the first game back, but I don't know. I'm not sure. I didn't think too much in the first couple of years of my footy career. That's just how I approached it. And obviously now I'm getting, obviously got. Put into the leadership group halfway through this year, so need to think a little bit more than now. So, but back then I just didn't think too much about anything. Yeah. I just did what I always did, and I just played my footy. And obviously, that has its negatives and benefits as well. But I just played footy and played good enough to stay in there. And you know, I ended up starting you know, the back end of the season at 13, I think, and that was pretty special for me. Because obviously Sam had played majority of his career at 13 for South, so it was massive for me doing that, and sort of, you know, blooding my way slowly into, you know, the role that I play for South now.
And so 2017 is when Madge moves on, and Anthony Siebold.
Yep.
You finished third that year, and I guess this is where you really start playing regular first grade. Did you feel like that season, you know, you not established yourself, but like became confident that you were a first grader?
Yeah, I did. And I felt good. I felt confident. I felt fit. It was different for me. I was coming off the bench most of the year.
Yeah.
Come about 20 minutes in, I'd go to 13 and I'd play 60 minutes out to the end of the game. It was a bit different for me. I wasn't used to it, but Yeah, I started getting a lot of confidence playing. I started, I guess, transitioning from that kid who turned up to training, trying not to upset anyone, knowing his place, to kind of really find him, you know, finding my role in the team and sort of trying to navigate my niche and, you know, and my role that I was playing. So,
and like impacting the game, bringing something rather than just being a part
of it. Exactly. So I think I developed like a passing game. I think that year was pretty pivotal.
Hey, you know what? People listening to this podcast will be like, Denon, how dare you try and correct anyone? Because I get words wrong all the time.
Pivotal in, in the role I play now. So, and that was a great year for us. And, you know, disappointing result at the end of the year too. But, I think that's the year that South really stamped their foot back on the competition and said, you know, we are a top four team and organization, and this is where we belong. And I don't think we've taken a back foot step since. So, that was a pivotal year for me and the club itself.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, and then so you've got beaten by Roosters in the prelim.
Yeah.
But Anthony Siebold leaves and goes to the Broncos, and obviously Wayne comes to the club. That was so dramatic. Yeah. Like, that was so dramatic how that all happened. What was it like as players? Because I know initially, you know, you guys, you know, really liked Siebold and you thought that he was going to be a coach for a substantial time, but obviously, you know, he went to the Broncos.
Yep.
It would have been hard because you would have, as a player, you don't, when you like a coach, you know, you want them to stay.
Yeah, exactly. I love Siebes. And I love what he did for me in my career, and I can never knock him for doing that. But yeah, obviously what happened and he left and Wayne ended up coming, and, you know, in hindsight, it's probably the best thing that ever happened to me and to a lot of boys. I know they appreciate Wayne and what he's done, and really look up to him and the person he is. And he's definitely improved South Sydney as a whole, but I think individually, like people in our team, like they've improved more off the field than anything, just like in terms of his life lessons and you know, sometimes he just like, he goes off on tangents and talks about life and buying houses and kids and stuff like that in the middle of a, you know, team meeting. But just, you know, those moments where you just sit down and listen to him, he's got so much wisdom.
Yeah.
And I think we learned so much from those talks. So yeah, there's a million little one-liners that Wayne says that has improved me as a person. I'm just so grateful for the last 3 years.
Do you remember your first interaction with Wayne or anything like that? Or
we got him up into like the, there's like a little function room, at Redfern Oval, introduced himself up there. I think we're on a pretty lean sort of fitness regime, and he walked up and he said, "You blokes look more like AFL players than rugby league players."
Oh, really?
Said something about that. But he just said he's...
So as in your fitness was very like a lot of running rather than footy oriented?
Yeah, I guess it was. Yeah, it was. There still was some like footy in and around that stuff, but I don't know why he said that. And I guess it was just a first impression.
Yeah.
But I just remember him saying that. I remember him saying he's really pleased to be here. He said he loves... foundational clubs, he loves the history that's been at this club and he can't wait to be a part of it. And I resonated really well with what he said. I was really looking forward to him coaching me, but obviously having someone like Wayne Bennett, I wanted to prove myself as well. And I remember him saying that. He said, I'm not going to do much. I'm not going to change anything. I'm not going to have much input. I'm just going to watch you for, you know, 1 or 2 months. And I think that was his way of weeding out the people that he liked and the people that I guess he didn't really necessarily like. And that was kind of like a rehearsal period for every player there to earn his trust.
Yeah.
So I remember being really excited but very nervous because I wanted to make sure
100%.
That...
100%. And you don't know how he feels.
No, you don't.
He gives you nothing.
Yeah, you don't. So that was really special, him coming there. And then obviously everyone had to get their shit together to make sure that they impressed the master coach.
100%. So that year, you earned representative honours. You were selected for New South Wales by coach Brad Fittler, played in all three matches, coming off the bench.
Bench, yeah.
Correct? Do you remember getting the call-up? I think I predicted that you would get the call-up. Did you feel like you were ready, or not ready because you played really well, but did you feel like it was something that was a surprise, not a surprise?
I guess I knew I could do the job if I, well, I didn't know, but I just knew I wanted to be there. Absolutely. Obviously, being there, I wanted to be in Origin Arena since you were a kid. So,
and you're confident in your ability. Like, if you play well, you'll do the job.
Yeah, yeah. And I was happy with my form at the start of 2019. I still think it's some of the best footy I've played. So I knew that I'd done enough to get their attention.
Mm.
But I didn't get my hopes up. I just said, you know, it is what it is. If I get the call, I get the call. If I don't, I don't. I don't want to get too caught up on it and stuff like that. So, yeah, I think I relaxed so much about it. I slept in when I got the call. I missed the call from Freddie.
Oh, really?
I called him back and he said, mate, you ready? I said, yeah, I'm ready. He said, all right, we'll send you through the details. And
yeah,
you know, it was a pretty brief chat. But, yeah, it was pretty special for me and obviously learned a lot that year. Playing rep footy, playing with different NRL players. I'd only played with South players before.
Yeah.
And all that type of stuff. It was a good little learning curve and obviously awesome. We won the series. It's such a great achievement winning an Origin series. So.
And do you remember, you know, the running on with that sky blue jersey or the first time you put it on? What was that feeling like?
Yeah, we ran out at Suncourt. That's why I said Suncourt, because that's probably up there. One of the best arenas I've run out to.
Yep.
They turn the lights off. They got lights flashing, fireworks.
Sick.
Crowd screaming, booing. Booing. Yeah. And so, yeah, that was incredible.
Yeah.
That was so special. I do remember that. I remember sitting on the bench, being a little bit nervous, but I was really excited to get on there. And yeah, we lost that game. But I still think I was still proud of how I played. And I still think that I still thought that I'd done enough to be there the next week. And so I was really looking forward to the next week, the next sort of Origin game, if I did get picked, to make sure that we could come back from it. And we did. So, it was crazy.
Mate, you had a great debut off the bench, great debut. And then obviously that was when Teddy scored to win it.
Yep.
And so you were actually the man, took the ball to the line to pass to Pierce, to pass to him. What were you thinking in that moment? Like, cause
I was
like,
just gassed.
Yeah, because I was thinking like, you're in your third Origin game. Usually you probably just take the tackle.
Yeah.
Were you just thinking, oh,
I was gassed. I was so gassed. But I knew that, like, because Boyd Cordner took the carry beforehand. He laid the scrum line.
Yeah.
And I knew we had, like, our little forward shape to get the ball out the back. I knew there was, like, 40 seconds to go.
Mm.
So I knew we had to do something. I knew I couldn't have just taken it up, got tackled. I knew I needed to do something. So I called the shape. I think we're missing one of the props there. So I just like, I went to pass it and no one was there. So I took another few steps forward and then I saw Piercy. So I just threw it to Piercy. Yeah. And then, Junior like threw it to Tommy, I think. And the rest is history.
And the great Fergie tiptoes down.
And then I just like potted my way as fast as I could because I was gassed to the huddle and it was crazy scenes.
Did you, like, I mean, obviously you dream of these things, but as a young kid, like, to think that you're in this moment of like this famous moment of Teddy winning it on the buzzer and you get to experience it.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, I just got to play with so many good players, even this year, like the team we had this year, and obviously every Origin team is so talented, but
the team this year was wow,
crazy. But yeah, even then, like, it's just such a pleasure to play with players of that caliber. It definitely improves you as a player. So
I'm
always better for it after an Origin series.
And you also were named Dally M Lock of the Year at the ceremony. What was, did you expect it, or was it a surprise, or?
I don't know. I honestly don't know. Like, I was going up against Taumalolo and he had a pretty special year that year, and you know the way they used to do it is like they put the points up after every round, and he was always in the top 10. I was thinking no chance I'm getting this.
Yeah,
and he was in the top 10 after round 24. I wasn't nowhere to be seen.
Yeah,
and I was like, all right, I haven't got it. And then I ended up getting 3 points in the last game, and I don't think he got any. And I just overtook him in the last thing. So like, it was pretty unexpected.
Yeah,
but I was definitely it was a great honor for me. And it topped off such a magical year for me, of just playing, you know, the footy that I played, the people I played with. It was a crazy year.
Pretty crazy, like to pip Jason Taumalolo. Like, he's one of the greatest forwards in the history of the game, period.
Yeah.
And you just pip, that's crazy. Did you have to go up and do a speech or anything?
No, only the person that wins a big one does the speech.
Okay, well, you're like, thank God.
I just shook hands. smiled.
Who gave it to you?
I don't know.
Can't remember.
I think it might have just been like, oh, I can't remember. I remember Brandy was up there. I think he might have, maybe he gave it to me. I'm not sure.
Man, lock of the year, how good. You also win the player's player for the Rabbitohs. And then you get selected the Australian side for the Oceania Cup. You made your test debut against Tonga.
Yeah.
What was that like?
Yeah, that was another great, there's so many good games that year. But,
yeah, what a year.
That was crazy, yeah. It was in Auckland.
Yeah.
99% Tongan fans in the stadium, loud as, just singing nonstop throughout the game. I felt like I was overseas in like a football match in like the Premier League or something like that. That's how crazy it was. It was deafening, but it was obviously tough result for us. Not the best debut, I think, for me personally. And then obviously we lost the game, but great experience again. And even up to that point, rugby league had already given me so much. I was just so grateful to be there. It was incredible.
Obviously, as an Aussie as well, Devo that we lost, but at the same time, so good for Tonga to see that, like, just that spectacle. That was they're on another level. Their fans, it's crazy how passionate they are.
Yeah,
I can't wait for international footy to come back.
Yeah,
so yeah, so you have that year. 2020 rolls around, and you're moved from 13 to second row. And I didn't like this. I was like, man, I think Murray's 13. What was the chat like with Wayne? Was it a size thing? You wanted more size? What was it?
I think Wayne just pulled me aside and said, mate, I trust you as a player. And I think you can play 12 for us. We were a bit short on back rowers that year.
Yeah.
So I think he just thought I was the next best fit.
Mm, yeah. Because you did. You absolutely did a job. I just like you better at 13. Yeah. Do you enjoy 13 more?
Yeah, for sure. Mm. I the middle is, I think I'm just way better suited for the middle. Like, I do enjoy second row too, and you do get a little bit more freedom. You play a little bit different.
Yep.
But yeah, I think, I don't know if that really worked out for us. And obviously he moved me back there into the middle halfway through the season because, we had a pretty abysmal start to the season that year. We slowly started to find our strides towards the back end of that year. But
to be fair, like, you were still developing Keon, still Jaden Sewer had just come to the club.
Yep.
So it bought you some time for them to develop as players?
Yeah, I guess so, yeah. And, obviously... I know Wayne asked me to, and I'll do anything Wayne tells me to do. So, and I was just happy to play wherever in the first grade side. Yeah. I've always been like that. It's always just an honor for me to put that red and green jersey on and represent our community. So I just, and I back myself too. Like, I played a lot of second row, like in the whole 2016 year in reserve grade, I was a back row. I didn't play lock. Yeah. So, okay. So I had a bit of experience there, maybe not so much in first grade, and I did my best, but I just don't think the dynamics worked as well as it could have. And I think having such a big year in 2019 in the middle, I think the players around us had adapted to me playing in the middle, and I'd got a lot better at talking, communicating, and organizing that middle. So I feel like when I went, a lot of communication and organization went from the middle too.
Mm.
And I'm not rubbishing anyone else.
It's
in
just
our
familiarity,
side.
Like, just being familiar with knowing, like, oh, he's going to be on my right, he's going to be on my left. It's not really. You can sometimes have the best player ever in a position, but if they're not familiar with the players around him, it just doesn't click. It takes too long to find that click.
Yeah, exactly. And you play to your strengths too. And the players that were in that middle, their strengths are, you know, typical front rower strengths: running hard, tackling hard, just being and being a workhorse.
Yeah.
And I complimented them in 2019 and they complimented me, and we played our best footy when it was like that. So I just think that we never really adapted enough or as well as we needed to without me being in the middle.
Yep.
So I guess that's why he moved me back there, and lucky he did, because I think it just worked a lot better for us, and I felt a lot more comfortable finishing the year off in the middle.
Yeah, no, almost. Much better. So 2020, then you get, obviously you guys prelim again, get knocked out. Were you starting to get like a bit like, oh shit, we're getting knocked out in prelims constantly?
Not really. Like, every year'd been different. The year before, I think we had a really good chance and we blew it.
Mm.
This year we were just like, we were like towards the end, we were like, I just felt, oh sorry, not this year, 2020. We had a lot of injuries. We had a lot of adversity we faced, and I don't think we were in the best stead leading into that prelim, and I don't think anyone actually thought we were going to get there in the first place.
Mm.
But typical of the way that we play and our sort of brand of foot is, and something that I think we're really proud of is we play our best. We leave everything out on the field.
Yep.
We never give up. So that was characteristics of that year and of that prelim final as well. Mm. So yeah, it was definitely a year of a lot of learning, and we were better for it this year, I think. Mm.
And what's it like, you know, being a 13 with the rule changes that happened that year too, with everything with the pandemic as well? What was it? Is the game really way faster? Like, what's it like in the middle?
It was, it does get fast.
Mm.
I think the rules, especially this year, maybe a little bit last year, really exposed the defense of a lot of teams. You need good defense, and you need to know how to work together to make sure that you're a sound sort of defensive unit.
Mm.
And that's what we really sort of realized after those two games we got flogged by this year.
Yeah.
And that's what we really focus on. And that's where we probably, on the back of that, that's where we run into most of our joy. So, I don't really know, to be honest. I don't really have too much opinion on the new rules. Like, I focus and think about the stuff that I need to think about, and that's it. I can't really control what's happening.
It is what it is, kind of.
Yeah, it is what it is. And it's the same playing field. Everyone's doing the same thing.
Yeah.
Refereeing the same way, so you just got to adapt and do your best.
Yeah.
So yeah, I do remember in 2020 it was a very hard transition for me. I felt like it was a really tough year for me. I don't know if I wasn't as fit or my energy levels, or I was hungover a little bit from the last year and all the hype around what happened there, or I didn't give myself enough break, or it was the rule changes. But 2020 was a really tough year for me in terms of conditioning wise. I felt really just hammered on the field the whole time. So I don't know if that's a rule changes, and I don't know if this year is, I'm just better because I've got a year under my belt or whatever. Mm. But yeah, like you said, it just is what it is.
Yeah, absolutely. But so at the end of the year, you suffer a hamstring injury in the first few minutes of Origin. Was that devastating, like to finish the year, like a frustrating year?
Yeah, it was. It was the first run of Origin. So
it was bad. It was like grade three.
Yeah, it was like, I'm not sure. There's two hamstring muscles, and so the one Latrell tore against Parramatta that year, like he did the big one. I did the small one. So mine was non-surgical. His was surgical.
Okay.
Or needed surgery. It was all right. Look, I kind of looked at it through in a way that when your body needs a rest and you're not giving it a rest, it forces you to rest.
Okay.
So I kind of took the good in it, although I was missing an Origin series, although it was killing me watching the boys lose from home. Selfishly, from my point of view, I just felt like my body did need a rest, and that's the way it sort of, that's the way it told me that it needed a rest. So, I think I gave myself the rest that I needed, and I definitely think that it helped me this year. So, it was devastating, a bit scary when it happened, but that's footy, and apart from missing the Origin series, it was a good time to do it because it led straight into the off season. So it made me stay off my feet as much as I needed to. And then it obviously made me rest leading into what was this year.
And so this year, when did you do your shoulder? Was it an accumulation or?
Yeah, it's like an accumulation overuse kind of thing. Like I got it done in 2018, a little less serious than this. The surgery was just like keyhole. And just from there, I never really recovered. I had a bit of a hiccup during my rehab process, and I'm not sure if that, was a factor in it not healing like it should have. But I've had problems with it since then, on and off. I've had a few minor subluxed it a little bit, a few times. So and painful. Yeah, I just got
so
it.
So painful when it's sublocked.
Yeah, just your whole arm goes numb. Yeah. So I just, I got a scan towards the end of this season, and it just got confirmed that I need to get this procedure done. And I just got through the last couple of games, and then, got it done pretty soon after. And, trying to look after it as best I can now.
Was it giving you trouble at the end of the year at all?
No, it actually felt really good at the end of the year. It was giving me more trouble at the start of the year.
Really?
And at the start of last year as well.
Mm.
I don't know if my body just wasn't used to the contact, or I just didn't have it as strong as I needed it to get through my rehab. But yeah, it was a weird one. But hopefully, this has fixed it.
Yeah, I mean, you should be sweet. Once I got my full shoulder reconstruction, I never had an issue with it.
Yeah, well, I've heard a lot of people say that, so I'm hoping for the best.
You rehab it so well, and it'll be even better now. You'll probably be stronger, honestly.
Yeah.
So this year, you round eight. Grade two, a syndesmosis injury out for 4 weeks.
Yeah.
Was that frustrating?
That was frustrating. That was one that I wasn't really used to. I'm not very injury prone, and so I don't have many in season injuries.
Yeah.
So that was a bit difficult for me to take. And then obviously it's the worst watching your side get flogged it did in the two games that I wasn't there. So yeah, it was really, really hard. But I guess the silver lining to that, again, was it made me more serious about my rehab, and it made me just want to get back sooner. So I just did everything I needed to do to get back. And, luckily it healed really well. I've got some good rehab staff at the club. So, I was able to get back pretty quickly. So I was happy with that.
And so, the Origin Series this year, you obviously win at 2-1, and you get you play on the edge though, but were you, did Fittler give you a job to do? You obviously got Fafita there, or was it just
No, he's pretty, he was pretty relaxed about it. He put me there, and again, he said he trusts me.
Mm.
And I think he's seen me play. I played a bit of centre towards the back end of 2020 because Wayne put me there because we were a bit short.
Mm.
I played a bit of back row, and I think Freddie knew that I had that versatility about me.
Mm.
And he just said, I think the way that you fit into this team best is obviously playing back row, and so I was put on that edge, and obviously been there a little bit, so I backed myself there. I knew I was coming up against David Fafita, and I knew that he was the X factor for them, so I knew I needed to do a job on him and do as best as I could on him to negate his attacking threats and what he does, which is hard job because he's the hardest person to tackle ever. Yep. So I focused on that a little bit, did a little bit of research about that, and we trained as best we could as a right edge, and obviously I had Cleary, Turbo, and Fox, I think.
Far out.
So
crazy.
I was playing with the best players in their positions in the league. So I was pinching myself just doing that, and I just didn't want to let anyone down. I didn't want to let Freddie down. I didn't want to let my edge down. So I just did everything I knew I needed to do to get the job done. And obviously the results were where we wanted it to be. So it was
what was it like seeing Trill and Tommy and that tear it apart in that game one?
I'm still in awe about it. They're just, when you get to play with players like that, it's a dream come true, And to see Teddy and Turbo and Trill just do their thing, backing themselves and just doing what they've done, it's just so special. I know that I'll, be able to look back one day and just, be proud that I was alongside those type of players.
Is there anything specifically that you do, when you're marking a guy like Fafita, is there anything specific that you try to do to shut him down, or is it more just stay in the game for every single minute, concentrate, make sure that every single tackle is... Because a lot of the time when you miss tackle, it's due to you're stepping out of the game. You're not staying focused. What is there anything specific you do?
Yeah, you can never switch off in Origin. We play a real high effort area kind of style of footy.
Mm.
So that kind of suited me a little bit. I think that I guess that's kind of one of my flags and one of the things that I try to focus on every week. Mm. So that suited me. I knew he had a big left foot step, so I was wary of that. And I knew that he breaks tackles when you try to tackle him up high. So I don't think I tried to tackle him up high once.
Yeah, okay.
So
he's so thick downstairs though. So
yeah, I know he is too, but just that's the best way to tackle him. Absolutely. Otherwise, he just like throws you off like a little kid.
Yeah.
So yeah, I just there and I didn't overthink it too much. I focused mainly on me, but if I was thinking any like about the opposition, it was probably mainly about him and especially in defense, what I needed to do to stop him.
Yep. No, it was a great performance on the edge there. So you win the series by a record margin. What was the chat like after that second game?
Yeah, it was incredible. It was so good. It was just winning at Origin. It's just it's hard to describe like that locker room feeling. And obviously you'll know what it is. But it's just there's not many things in life better than knowing that you've all done your job, you all did what you trained to do, and we got the job done together. It's so satisfying, and just it's just really special to share those types of moments with you know, your Blues brothers. So it was great.
And so going into this year, will you be good for round one, or will you still be recovering?
I think it's like a 4 to 6 month recovery. So I think there's potential I might miss the first couple of rounds, but it obviously depended on how well I progress through the rehab process.
That'd be annoying if you don't start the season.
Yeah.
What's it like, you know, Wayne moved on, Benji obviously retiring, Dimitri is now the coach. Are you excited to do the first year with Dimitri?
Yeah, I can't wait. There's staff that come to, you know, new staff that come to the club, and you know they're you know, head coach material when they come. And I knew Siebes was like that when the way he was presenting, the way his engagement, his due diligence, and all that type of stuff. And then I just knew that about JD as well. So I'm really excited to see how he handles it. I'm really excited to compliment. We'll try my best to compliment the way that he approaches coaching, and I think he's going to do a really good job. He's got the respect of every single one of our players, and I know everyone's looking forward to a big season, especially coming up short. We'll use that as motivation to make sure that we do everything we can to get back into that grand final next year. So it's going to be a long process, and I know it's going to be pretty intense preseason, but you know, it is what it is, and I'm really looking forward to see what we can do this year.
And who is a bigger pest, Cody Walker, Adam Reynolds?
I don't know. They're different.
Different kind of pests.
Different kind of pests. like Cody will come and pinch your leg.
Oh, fuck. That's bad.
Pull your hair out or something. Do something like that.
Oh, my God.
Reynolds will just walk around screaming and like singing and and stuff like that. So I don't know. Equally. Probably Cody Walker because it's more annoying.
Physically hurting you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Reno's just funny.
What's the end? Like, because you're in a really good spot in your career where, you know, you've got options and, you know, you have the power to really affect a club, and also you've got the power to, like, just begin a legacy or whatever. Is an end goal to be a captain of the club if you could, or is that something that if it comes, it comes? If it doesn't come, it doesn't come?
Yeah, I think what you said at the end there, if it comes, it comes. Look, I'm not really I don't want to seem disrespectful or anything towards captains or anyone or any aspiring captain, but it's not one of my goals to be captain. One of my goals is to be successful collectively as a group, and I'll leave that decision in the hands of the coaching staff and the people who know best. And if it comes, I'll grab it with both hands and I'll be the best captain I can be. If it doesn't, then I've got confidence in any one of our leaders in our group that they can do the job, and I'll make sure that I'm doing everything I can to complement their leadership as captain. But my goal is just to be successful as a club. I just want to win footy games. I want to win a premiership. So, that's my response to, like, you know, if I want to be captain, like, of course, I'll grab it with both hands. I'll treat it with respect, and I'll do everything I'll need to do to be a captain. But my focus is just to, you know, make sure I'm doing everything, like, just it's just like a process driven sort of mindset. And my focus is right now is just to get my shoulder right, make sure I'm doing the conditioning that I can do while I'm in a sling, and then progressively just building from there into you know, into a form of me that's mentally and physically strong enough to perform at the level that I know I can perform at and know that I need to perform at, to, you know, to complement the players around me and to, you know, to be a integral part of what we're doing at South. So, yeah, really looking forward to another big year, hopefully.
And got any hobbies outside of footy?
I struggle with this question, man. I don't really have that much hobbies. I like reading books. I'm a bit nerd.
What books are you reading?
I'm reading like this like farming book at the moment.
Yeah.
I'm really into agriculture for some reason at the moment. It's called Call of the Reed Warbler.
Okay. And what? And it's is it fictional or is it?
No, it's like a
guide?
Memoir maybe?
A dude that was like a farmer.
So it's a guy who's a farmer and it's like he's a regenerative agriculture. Like he does regenerative agriculture and he talks about like ecological.
So regenerative agriculture is essentially like an ecosystem is being damaged and you're trying to bring it back to
exactly.
its good state.
So it's like industrial sort of farming versus like regenerative agriculture or biodiversity and organic sort of farming. Mm. I'm not an expert on it by all means, but I'm reading up about it a little bit now. Yeah. I don't know if why I'm interested in agriculture at the moment, but
Is it a biography or is it him talking about the ways that they can help the earth?
That. Yeah.
Okay.
Else? I don't even know what else I've like. I like catching up with friends every now and then. I like the beach.
What's something that a lot of people would be surprised that you enjoy?
It's a hard question.
Whether it's like something that you watch on YouTube or music that you kind of like.
Yeah, I like gangster rap before I like before I like on the bus. I got my own little routines. I like gangster rap like on the bus leading to a stadium, especially the big games.
Yep.
Get me really.
What's your go-to? Who's your go-to artist?
Anything Drake. I like 21 Savage. I don't mind like the Aussie drill rappers.
Yeah, 1-4 on that. Hooligan Hefs.
What else? Yeah.
Are you like NBA Youngboy?
Pop Smoke.
Yeah.
I don't. It's not like I don't have the best repertoire of like gangster rappers on my Spotify, but fair bit there.
Gangster rap, man.
That's it. I'm everyone. Like different situations, different music.
Yep.
Different vibes.
Are you a coffee man? A bloke that just like likes to go to coffees?
Yeah, I love sit down, have breakfast, have a coffee. I'm not a connoisseur at all. I'll drink any coffee, but I love sitting down.
You know what's crazy is like when I was coming through, like you're like, oh, let's go for coffee. You'd be like, what?
Oh, really?
Serious, bro?
That's changed.
Now it's like, that's all. Coffees is everything in rugby league. If your team isn't going coffees, you're not a team.
Yeah, I know.
It's like
people do coffee runs every morning. That's what we're doing up there. People 100%. Go in the local cafe, coffee runs for the team room.
Absolutely. It's always like finish training. Oh, let's go for coffee.
Yeah.
Oh man, yeah. When we were coming through, we just didn't.
Yeah,
we just sat around and put shit in each other. Really, that's all we did. Just fucking bagged each other.
I don't know. I just like sitting down. Like I'm a bit of a perfectionist, and like I think professional sports turns you into a bit of a perfectionist.
Mm.
A little bit like maybe some minor OCD. I don't really like the idea of like playing 18 holes of golf. Like I feel like. I'll do my back or something, or I'll be tired for training the next day.
Absolutely.
No shit to anyone that does that. Yeah. I'm sure it works for you, but it just wouldn't work for me. I'm more of like, I work hard at training, but I'm the laziest person ever.
I don't want to bloody go out and be hitting golf balls after I've just been towed up. But some people love it.
Yeah. Yeah. Some people do. Some people are sick for it.
I'm a sloth, bro. After I finish training, I'm lying down.
Yeah.
But I still have little OCD things. Like even I went for a jog this morning. It was probably the slowest jog in the history of mankind. Fuck, man. So overweight. But even like little things, like if I make a decision of like, that's the finish line, I've got to run all the way through it.
Yeah.
Because in my head, when we trained all the time, if you slowed right down, the coach would rip you. Yeah. Be like, you fucking lazy fucker.
That's like the number one, like, no, don't do it. Don't stop before the line.
Don't stop before the line.
Don't
holy
touch
shit.
The poles, all that stuff.
Yeah, that's another thing. Like every time I go for a walk with the missus, even now, initially she didn't do it, but she would like cut corners.
Yeah. Like across the grass.
Across
like
the grass. The strip.
Yeah.
And I'll be like, fuck, no, go all the way to the end. And exactly. That all from footy. Cause like, there's always like getting in trouble. Like, yeah, if you even cut a corner, everyone's doing extras.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
All right, favorite rapper of all time?
Oh, I don't know. I go through phases. I used to love Eminem when I was young.
Mm.
I love Drake now.
Drizzy.
Drizzy.
Do you like his new album?
Yeah, I like it. Oh, yep. I like most of the songs in it.
Yeah. Yep. It's all right.
Yeah, what, do you like it? No.
It's solid. It's easy listening.
Yeah.
It's not as good as some of his old stuff, but how can you can't expect him to like it's like Eminem, like he's only competing against himself.
Yeah,
like if Drake put out that album, if someone not named Drake put out that album, you'd be like, this is hectic.
Yeah, yeah.
But because he's got so many classics.
Yeah, yeah.
What
do you listen? What's that? Is Drake your go-to or what? What
my
do you
go-to, man. I listen to pretty weird stuff, like very like there's a band called Magic Jordan, very R&B-ish, very underground. Like then I might listen to like kind of like alternative acoustic sometimes.
Yeah, okay.
The Weeknd. Don't like country.
You don't like country?
Not a country guy. Like for example, this morning I was listening to Jewel, You Were Meant For Me.
Yeah, what's
you know
that?
The song Jewel, You Were Meant For Me?
I don't know, might.
We'll put it up. This, you'll know it as soon as it comes on, trust me. We'll put it up to the speakers. Oh, come on. Oh, that's fine. The people listening will know.
Yeah.
It's a classic. That's a banger.
Yeah, I don't know. I have to Shazam that or something.
Mate, it's a great song. Jewel, You Went For Me. It's a classic. It must be past your generation.
Yeah, maybe.
Because you're 23?
Yeah.
What are you? 26. Why do you act like you're 16? yeah, it must be past your generation. Favorite movie of all time?
I remember you asked me this last
time. Yeah, last time. You don't want to change your answer?
They haven't changed.
Bro, trust me, the podcast was way smaller back then. There's going to be like heaps more people that listen to it now.
All right. Oh, that puts me under the pump even more. I don't know. I love Django.
Django Unchained's great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm trying to think of like recent movies. I haven't watched many like new movies.
I can't wait till Dune comes out in the cinemas. I'm keen as for that. Dune.
Is that the one where the guy, nah, it's the, what's his name?
That's Shia LaBeouf or whatever. Not Shia LaBeouf, but...
Alec Baldwin?
Not Alec Baldwin.
That one. The guy, Alec Baldwin that shot the...
Oh, no, nah, not that. That's Rust. That's called Rust. Rust. But that won't be out for a while. There's a movie called Dune and there's the main guy is like a young... I can't believe I've forgotten his name. But he's also in a movie called The King.
Yeah.
I'll get his name up now. But he's a gun.
Yeah.
The King on Netflix is mad. You should try that.
King, yeah.
If you like those old school movies.
Yeah. I like a bit of everything.
Timothy Chalamet. He's like the next heartthrob in Hollywood.
Yeah, okay. I'll make sure I watch it then.
Yeah, the King's good. Yeah. I want to watch the Last Duel. It's got Matt Damon, Ben Affleck.
Oh, I love good. I like watching movies with the actors that I like in it. Like I love Denzel Washington.
He's a gun.
Yeah, I love
He's Denzel. The GOAT in my opinion. Yeah. Greatest actor of all time.
Yeah, he's up there.
Him, and then underneath it's probably like Leonardo DiCaprio, Bale, Michael Bale. Is it, what's it, Christian Bale?
Christian Bale, yeah.
The new Batman movie looks mad.
Is there a new?
Yeah, with
out of it.
Robert Pattinson from Twilight.
Oh, really?
Trust him to know that. Fucking said Twilight. It straight away. You're a fucking weirdo, bro. Fucking weirdo, man. These fucking 26-year-olds watching Twilight and shit. If everything happens perfectly in the next 12 months, where are you and what are you doing?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's a bit premature to ask me that because obviously I'm still in chill out mode from the last season. But there'll definitely be a time I sit down and write out some goals. I obviously want to keep pushing to play good footy and I want to be in the Origin arena again. Mm. I want to keep developing my game in that arena. I want South to be performing like they did last year. So I want to be top four and obviously I want to win a grand final.
Mm.
So that'll them two are up there. I'm not sure. That's probably as far as it goes, like as simple and as far as it goes on field.
Mm. What about off field?
Yeah, off field. That's an interesting one. I've got a million ideas and I've done a lot of thinking and I mean ironing, but I haven't really actioned anything yet. So I'd like to action something off the field, whether that be start a business,
What industry would you enter, go into?
I don't know yet. Yeah. I've got ideas. I don't know if I should share them.
Don't want to put them out there yet?
Yeah.
Nah, that's all right. That's all right.
Yeah, so I might do that. I just announced an F45 ambassadorship.
Oh,
with
yeah.
them.
How good's that? That's
yeah,
sick.
It's good. So, like, yep. I'd love to get more involved with them.
Yep.
And look at the possibility of owning franchises through them.
Yep.
They just obviously got the F45, like the high intensity training sort of franchise, but they just brought out a new mash between Pilates, tone, and yoga called FS8. I'm a big Pilates fan, so yep. I'd love to sort of explore that and see what the workouts are like there, and then obviously maybe develop something down the track there. So there's a lot of exciting things on the horizon, I think, and I'm really looking forward to it. But obviously everything starts with footy. I need to be playing good footy.
Yeah, that's serious. I was going to say that you can get all the brand deals in the world, but unless you're playing good footy, that's all that matters.
100%. So I just I just want to make sure that I'm as fit and ready as possible come round one. So I've had a lot of time off now. I'm starting now to sort of like move more into like the recovery rehab process now, and then obviously start and do some cardio, like sitting on a watt bike and stuff like that. So I just want to make sure that I'm ticking every box there to make sure that physically I'm in the best shape possible.
All right, bro. Thank you so much for coming on. Good luck next season. Obviously, we'll stay in contact, and Dunskies.
Thanks, mate. Appreciate it.
Boom.